fellow chess fans, welcome to another edition of Chess Chat, a program designed to give you, the viewer, a good understanding of the fascinating world of chess. I am George Merejanian, program director of the Wachusett Chess Club at Fitchburg State University. This club meets every Wednesday evening from 7 to 11 in room C-159 of the McKay Complex at the university. And with me today at the Fitchburg Access Television Production Center is our award-winning director, Darren Dame of Fitchburg. He's assisted in the control room by fellow resident and longtime Wachusett Chess Club member, Brian Bigelow. And behind the camera is another longtime FATV volunteer, fellow resident, Andy Hawthorne. And across from me, once again, is my trusty co-host, longtime associate, chess author, and accomplished chess player, Dave Kuchar of Westminster. Hello, Dave.
Hi, George.
Well, Dave, a couple of weeks ago, the Massachusetts Chess Association held its 87th annual Massachusetts Open Championship. Do you know what this championship decides in the state?
The state champion.
It is the state championship.
I didn't realize it went back 87 years.
That's 87 impressive. Years, right, back to the Depression, back to, 1931, 32?
Wow.
Yeah, so chess was played even during the Depression.
Yeah.
And the Mass Chess Association held it at the Best Western Royal Plaza Hotel in Marlborough. And we have now three new state champions because we had three people who tied for first in this year's event.
Mm-hmm.
And we, at our director, Darren Dame, has some photos of these people. Let's show them. Let's actually show who our current state champions are. The first one we're going to see is probably someone who has won it before. Yes, this is Mika Brattain. He's 20 years old. He lives in Lexington. He's going to be entering his junior year at Ohio State University, where he's studying engineering.
Mm-hmm.
But he has won this actually for the third time. He won it clear actually in 2014. By himself, no sharing title. In 2016, 2 years ago, he shared the title with International Master David Vigorito and National Master Chris Williams. And again, this year, he's sharing the title with two other people. Let's see the next person with whom Mika Brattain shares the title. This is World Chess Federation Master, FIDE Master, Nathan Salon, who grew up in Michigan. He's 33 years old, and he moved to Massachusetts last year, 2017. But he, you know what, besides being a very accomplished chess master, he is a chess teacher and a professional poker player.
I didn't know.
Yes,
that.
Nathan Salone is a poker player, professionally. And our third person who shares the title this year as the Mass Open is National Master Michael Isakov, who is from Sudbury, and I believe he may have graduated from Lincoln Sudbury Regional High School.
Okay.
He's either has finished school or has one more year left.
Okay.
But he is actually, this is his first Mass Open title that he shared with the two others. So those are the three Massachusetts state champions. Now let me indicate to our viewers that this tournament was held in four sections. You had the championship section where you had the three players, Brattain, Isakov, and Salone, who tied for first.
Yep.
But we had three other sections based on rating. There was an under 2100 rating section, under 2100, under 1800 rating section, and under 1500 rating.
Mm-hmm.
That was the main event, because this event was held over the Memorial Day weekend, May 26th to the 28th, three days of solid chess, two rounds per day, six rounds total. And let me point out actually who won in the other sections. The under 2100 section, if I get the information, because I had it before me, who was that? That was, I believe, was a Michael Carey. If I get this, give me time here. Yes, it was Michael Carey of Providence, Rhode Island. He won it clear. He did it all by himself. Didn't share the title in that section. And in the under 1800 section, it was won by Vinith Naredi of South Grafton, near Worcester.
Yep.
Now, okay. And then we had a clear winner in the under 1500 section. It was won by Ranjan Day of North Andover. But what's interesting about that section, the under 1500 section, one of our local players tied for second place and also won a, also shared in a under a rating prize, under 1350 rating prize, and that was our own Mariano Rivera.
Yeah.
Now, we must have a photo of Mariano Rivera of Leominster. Let's see this photo of Mariano Rivera, because Mariano Rivera, here pictured in the foreground here, is actually the player with the hottest streak at the Wachusett Chess Club. You know why? He has won a prize at every single tournament that he's played in since he joined the Wachusett Chess Club in mid-February of this year, 2018. He's played in three club tournaments already.
Yeah.
He played in the George O'Rourke Memorial, the Everett Siskin Memorial, and the Martin Lane Memorial. He actually won prizes in those tournaments.
Yeah.
But he's played on weekends.
Yeah.
He's played actually the Massachusetts Game 60 Championship back in April. He actually tied for second in that event. The big one was actually the one where he played in Sturbridge. He actually tied for first in his section in the Eastern Class Championship. And then he also, in this Mass Open that we've talked about and indicate who our winners are, he tied for second in this tournament. And that is why we have picked out a game. We thought it was very appropriate that we would pick out a game played by one of our local players, Mariano Rivera, who hails from San Antonio, Texas. He graduated from the University of Texas at San Antonio. And you know what he does for a living?
No, I don't.
He's a financial analyst. He's a senior financial. His background is finances. Maybe our city of Fitchburg or Leominster may need his services because he knows all about finances, mm-hmm. Mariano does. But that's what he does for a living, but he loves chess. And he said when he joined the club back in February, he says, you know, I'm looking forward with a good relationship with the Wachusett Chess Club here at Fitchburg.
He's definitely having a meteoric rise.
Yes,
his rating is
because
doing that right.
Because
now.
Right now his rating, right, he has his national rating has skyrocketed since he's joined the club, and we expect more out of. In fact, he's now playing in the Wachusett Chess Club Championship Division B division.
Yep.
And I expect that Mariano might be there next year in the top division.
Right.
So don't count Mariano Rivera out.
Nobody does.
In this Mass Open that he played in a couple of weeks ago, he played actually a girl from India in the third round. They had both won their first two rounds, and they were paired against each other in the third round. And that's the game we're going to present to our viewers, because this is a very instructive game. And we can learn from this.
Mm-hmm.
So who had white in that game that was played in round three in the under 1500 section of the Mass Open?
So his opponent.
Prachi Dayal. Yes, from India.
Yep.
She has a World Chess Federation rating. She's played in India. Yeah, she played back in India to gain a World Chess Federation rating.
Right.
So she's no slouch, she's got experience. So she opened the game. What did she play as her first move?
She played e4 as her first move.
Okay, all right, so a good opening move.
Yeah.
What Mariano responded with was with c5, moving the pawn c7 and c5. Now what is this? This is a defense known as?
The Sicilian.
Sicilian defense, okay.
Very popular.
One of the most popular defenses to play against e4.
Right.
So what did Prachi on her second move do?
She plays the most common second move, which is to develop the knight.
Right, okay. And that prepares something. When you bring the knight to f3, it actually is to prepare the advance
You're
of that d-pawn. You assume.
Yeah.
What Mariano did or could do, he could actually bring his knight to c6. He could bring this pawn on a7 to a6. He could bring the pawn on e7 to e6. But he played d6. Good move.
Very
popular. Bobby Fischer played this. Yeah, mm-hmm. That was something that he always favored, this move on the second move. All right. So how does White continue?
So he does, in fact, play d4 as his third move.
Okay, Prachi.
She does.
So d4. All right, so what Mariano did is just capture the pawn. C takes D4 was his third move. So that pawn is gone. Okay, we'll get rid of that. Now, how does she respond? Does she recapture?
She recaptures with the knight, which is, again,
yes,
the most common way to recapture.
Yeah, because if she recaptured with the queen would come under attack
right,
from this knight. All right,
right,
so this is the proper way to take back with the knight. Now, here's where Mariano played knight F6, which attacks the undefended pawn
right
on E4. Okay, so what does Paracci do now?
Again, standard fifth move, knight to C3, defending the pawn.
Okay, it's defended. Okay, now, in this position, there are a number of good moves possible.
Right.
A6 is very popular.
Yeah.
The so-called Nydorf variation.
Yeah.
E6 is playable. That's
yep
also good. But you know, I noticed especially among scholastic players, the G6, which by the way, Carissa Yip, our mm-hmm former Wachusett Chess Club champion, this is part of her repertoire.
Okay.
She likes this continuation. By the way, do we actually have a variation now with a name by this advancement of the pawn, the G6?
This is called the dragon.
The dragon
variation.
Now, you know, when I saw this, I said, you know, I've always wondered, why is this called the dragon variation? And I found out why.
Yeah.
Okay, you want to hear why? Maybe our viewers would like to know why.
Yep.
The dragon variation was named after a constellation, Draco. Draco is a constellation in the northern sky. And Draco is the Latin word for dragon.
Yep.
There was a Russian master by the name of Fyodor Duzhotemirsky. You've probably heard it. Maybe you've heard it.
Right.
Well, okay. No, but if you play the Dutch defense as you do, Fyodor Duzhotemirsky was fond of the Dutch defense.
Okay.
Anyways, this Russian master claimed that he coined the term dragon variation back in 1901 in Kiev, Ukraine, because he said, you know, when he saw this pawn structure, you see how the pawns are
right
on D6, E7, F7, G6, H7?
Right.
He said, and he, by the way, was an amateur astronomer.
Okay. Yeah.
He said, wait a minute. He's looking up in the skies. He's remembering this position coming about. He says, wait a minute. This looks like a dragon, the back of a dragon.
Yep.
So he says, I threw out the term dragon variation for this, and it stuck.
It stuck, yeah.
It stuck.
Still
and that's
that
the origin of why this is called the dragon variation, after this Russian master who claimed that he coined the term.
But I
digress. Let's continue with the game.
Okay.
So what did White do? What did Paracci do now?
Six move, bishop to E3.
Okay. So she's developing another piece, okay.
Looks like she might castle on the queen side.
Okay. Now, before we play Mariana's next move, I think it's very instructive to show our viewers an opening trap.
Yeah.
Okay. This has been asked a number of times by players over the years. Why cannot this knight on F6 go to G4 and attack this bishop on
right
E3? Remember, it's protected by the bishop here on C8.
Right.
But this is a big blunder.
Right. So if you're watching online,
if you're watching online here,
pause the video and
never, yes, if you
see
read,
if you can figure out.
Yes, can you figure out why this is a big mistake? Because I will tell you now that this move will cost
black.
It will cost black a piece,
right,
or either a full piece or the exchange. That is a rook.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Do we have given our viewers enough time?
I think so.
Because the punishing move is bishop b5 check.
Right.
And we've got to get out of check. And
right
the only way to get out of check is we've got to block.
We've got to block.
And if we block with the knight c6, we're going to allow white to take here.
Exchange.
And then on the take back here.
Right.
Then the bishop would take on c6, forking the king and the rook.
Right.
And the rook would be lost.
Right.
Okay. So we can't allow that. So what we do here is we don't block with the knight on c6. What happens if we block and put a piece on d7?
Mm-hmm.
Either if we go with the bishop d7,
yeah,
or with the knight to d7, either piece that blocks here on d7 allows white to do what?
To
the queen
take
and wins that piece.
Right.
So that is how a blunder like knight g4 will lose a piece.
Yeah.
Again, it's easy to digress, but mm-hmm we gave you a lesson on an opening trap that you'll never
not
forget.
To play, yeah.
Not to play knight g4. Okay, what Mariano played was bishop g7.
G7.
Okay, now, What did Prachi do
now? Prachi now plays f3.
Okay, that, yeah.
To prevent.
Yes, now to prevent this knight from going to g4. Yep. Okay. It still couldn't do that.
And she doesn't really care that she's opening this up because she's going to castle this way.
All right, so Mariano castled.
Yep.
He castles down, and it is now White's
eighth move.
Eighth move coming up. So what did White do?
White plays queen d2.
Okay.
Developing the queen, preparing the castle.
Yes, it looks like it vacates the squares to allow White to castle on the queen side.
Right.
Okay, what Mariano did after queen d2 was play developing. He's behind in development. He's got more pieces developed here. He plays knight c6.
Right.
All right, so the knight goes there. Okay, so what does Prachi do now?
On her ninth move, she castles queenside.
Okay.
And this, this is pretty typical, I think, of the Sicilian, where White castles queenside, Black castles kingside.
Yes.
White attacks here, Black attacks here, and it's a race.
It is a race. So who first come, first serve?
First win,
right, exactly. So who's faster?
Right.
The person who's going to win this is the one who's faster with the attack.
Right.
All right. So what Mariano did after Prachi castled queenside here was to play the bishop on c8 to d7. All right, so it's a developing the piece here. We're vacating this square on c8 for a possible rook to get to this file, this
open
c file. Half open file. Okay, what did White do now?
Now White plays bishop to c4, which it seems reasonable. It's a developing move.
Yes.
But the main move that gets played here is to just start the attack immediately with g4.
Followed by h4?
Followed perhaps by h4. Possibly followed
pushing
by this
the,
pawn
yes.
pushed or this pawn pushed.
Yeah, so the idea is the White should
attack
have
quickly.
Started the attack immediately
right.
with the pawn on the king side. But she developed. But she's getting
it's not
a piece. There's not a mistake.
Right.
It's not a blunder
right.
or anything. It develops a piece on. It looks like a good diagonal here.
Yeah.
So what did Mariano? What he did in response to that was come with the knight on c6 to a5 and attack the bishop.
Right.
So that bishop now. That bishop. What's it going
to
do?
Right. She has to do something.
Is she going to go back to e2,
right.
maybe? No.
She either has to move it or
move
defend it.
So right.
she pulls it back to b3.
All right, so
bishop. Her 11th move.
All right, so bishop b3 was her move. And here is where Mariano says, you know what? I've got to get rid of that light squared bishop. It'll make my life a little easier if I can eliminate that bishop. Knight takes b3, check. All right, so that bishop is gone. So how does Prachi take back? There's three different ways to take back that knight.
Right.
Either with one of those two pawns or with the knight.
She takes back with the knight. Knight takes b3.
Yeah, this way, if she keeps her pawns connected.
Yeah.
All right, so now what does Mariano do after knight takes b3? Well, what he does, he starts his attack pushing the a pawn to a5. It looks like he wants to advance this pawn on the a-file.
It's usually pretty obvious in this opening what the plans are.
Now, you see, White has done nothing about starting an attack kingside, where Mariano is already starting his attack queenside. All
right.
So what does White do now after a5?
So what she does is bishop h6.
All right. Now you had a comment on this. I mean, you told me that when you subjected this position to the computer frowned upon this move. Did it not? Is it okay or is it something better? Is it something better?
It definitely preferred the knight here.
Yes.
Control that square
so
that Mariano couldn't push that pawn.
So this was a better move.
Better move.
She had a better move by playing the knight to d4.
And the thing is, I can see why she did this, because it's very common when one side's fianchettoed their bishop to try and get rid of it.
Yes, right.
So it's just
like a natural response.
It's a natural sort of thing.
Right.
But it's sort of going to backfire here because we'll see.
All right.
What happens?
Well, when she played bishop h6, Mariano, I think, took.
He
took bishop takes h6. That's what he did. And, of course, she has to take back.
Queen takes h6. And the problem, as we'll see, is that queen is just kind of stuck.
All by itself. There's no backup here.
The attack is coming here, and the queen could be defending.
Now, if these pawns had been advancing earlier, right, and try to open, see, the idea is to try to open up this H file, but right, you can't do it without moving in right, the pawns, the H pawn, right, the G pawn. All right, so here is where Mariano, after queen takes H6, advances. He doesn't advance to A4, which he could have done, but he realizes, okay, I'm going to go to B5 with the pawn.
Yeah.
All right? All right, so
which, like we said, would have been prevented if the knight,
yes,
was there.
Yeah, the knight was better off being on D4, would have stopped that B5 move. Okay, so what does Paracci do now after B5?
She pushes E5.
Okay.
Which trying actually, to open things up.
Right, she's trying to, she's attacking the knight, also attacking the pawn. In fact, we have a double attack on this pawn here. Yeah. So what Mariano did, he takes
he
this
takes
pawn.
It, yeah.
The D pawn takes on E5.
Yeah.
D takes E5, okay? So what does Paracci do now after E5?
Well, you know, we think the reason she did this,
yes,
was to
yes,
pin this bishop. So
yes,
she now she wins the pawn because
right,
that bishop is pinned.
Right.
But we were saying this is probably a mistake.
Yes.
That she's opening up this file for black.
Then what she should have done, let's put that
right,
pawn back.
What she could have
I think
done,
you point out to me that this was a better move.
Right.
Knight
so
c5
attacking,
with a double attack, although it is defended here.
Right.
But it is good to keep the pressure on this file. And if we can maybe double the rooks here, or I mean,
right,
or maybe bring this, well, yeah, this was a better move.
It definitely puts pressure on black.
It does put pressure on black here by playing the knight here.
Yeah.
But she chose to take pawn, okay.
Not fully realizing
not, yeah,
what
right,
was
exactly,
come.
All right. Well, this is going to cost time because now Mariano plays the queen to B6,
right,
attacks this knight on B5.
Attacks the knight and allows yes, this other rook to come over too, if need be.
That's true, yes, because this because with the queen here, the rooks are not connected.
Right.
Now we're going to be able to get these rooks maybe into play here,
right,
with the queen now attacking this
yep,
the knight on B5. All right, what does she do?
Well, so she pulls it back to C3.
But when
in retrospect, probably pulling it back to A3 would have been better.
Yes.
It would prevent this pawn from pushing down to A3.
Yes. Yeah, this is a better move.
Yeah.
Not yes, here was a better move. But she chose to play back
brought
there.
Brought it back to C3, knight
okay,
to C3.
Okay. Now here is where Mariano says, okay, I'm going to continue
right,
with my attack,
yeah,
advance the pawn to A4, and attack the knight. Remember, this knight cannot take this pawn because it's defended twice,
right,
for one thing, bishop
right,
and rook. So this knight has to move here.
Right.
It's under attack. All right, so where does that knight go?
Knight to D2.
All right. So, yeah, it could have gone to A1, but that would have been really passive
right,
to go back there. Now, here is where Mariano plays the rook on A8 over to B8.
Yeah.
And what is he threatening?
He's threatening checkmate. In
checkmate
one move,
right here. He's threatening mate on B2. So she cannot allow to
right,
be mated on B2 with the queen.
Right.
She only has one move to stop
pretty
this.
Pretty much, yeah. She plays B3.
She has to play B3, okay. And what Mario does after she plays B3, he doesn't take here initially. He brings this rook on F8 over to C8 and now attacks the knight, which
yeah,
is now not defended.
Right.
Because of the pawn that been pushed to B3.
Yeah,
so
right,
what is Paracci going to do now after rook FC8? Does she have to say, she has to protect this knight or
yeah,
move this knight? She
right,
can't allow that knight to be taken.
Yeah.
So what she did on her 20th move, I believe,
yeah,
is play what?
Knight on D to E4.
Right. The knight on the D file. Yeah, knight on D2 goes to E4. Okay, so now that knight is protecting the knight on C3. Okay, so now what we're going to do? Well, now Mariano says, okay, I think I'm going to take the pawn on B3 with the pawn.
Yep.
A takes B3, which he does.
Yep.
A takes B3.
Yeah, Mariano plays this very well.
Yes.
And Paracci plays A takes B3.
All right.
On her 21st.
Okay, and in response to that, Mariano plays knight takes E4. Knight takes E4. Okay, now, can't take back with the pawn because this rook now
right,
is attacking this knight. So
right,
it's forcing the knight to take back. To save this knight. Yeah.
Right. So unfortunately, now she's pretty much left without defenders over here.
Yeah. Look how strong.
Everything's.
Yeah. Right. This is very strong attack here. Now, what Mariano did after knight takes e4, he now is able to take this pawn on b3 with the queen because of the pin.
Right.
Queen takes b3.
So that pawn can't take because of
that pin.
From the rook.
And is it actually black threatening checkmate here on c2 with the queen?
Yes.
Yeah, or even with the rook, for that matter. I mean, the threat is to checkmate on c2.
Right.
So how does she get out of this?
This is probably the only.
She hopes to make a run for it. Okay, so she goes the king d2.
Yep.
Well, he responds with rook takes c2 check. All right. And she only has one move here.
One choice, king to e1.
King e1 is her only move. Okay, and Mariano, in response to that, plays rook on c2, takes on g2, the pawn on g2, which also now takes away the defender from the pawn. Now he's also threatening this pawn on f3 with the queen, for one thing.
Yep.
So what does Paracci do now after rook takes g2? She's
definitely in trouble.
She definitely is in trouble. Yeah, absolutely. So she wants to.
She brings the knight back to help defend and.
And also attacks the queen.
Attack the queen.
All right. So after knight d2 attacking the queen, the queen moves, and the queen moves here. Queen to d3, and we can see what the threat is. Does Paracci see the threat? Well, this is an act of desperation. I'm sure that she knew that this game was going to be over. Instead of resigning, other players would have resigned in this position because there is no defense. There is no defense here. I mean, is there any defense? No, there is none. What she did is she brought here. What was the move she played here on her 26th move?
She plays rook to c1.
Okay, yeah, but it doesn't do it.
Gives the king a space, you know.
Right. Yeah. Right. It gives the king this square. This d1.
If Mariano were to have played this, I guess.
She
could have gone
but it's not going to change the result.
Because
desperate. How Mario ended the game was playing queen e2 checkmate.
Yep.
And this is how the game ended against Paracci Dayal. And again, Mariano went on to, again, tie for second, which is very good for him. Because, again, these Mass Open tournaments are very strong.
Right.
They tend to bring out the strongest players, not only in Massachusetts, but from New England,
right?
Because it is an open tournament,
right?
So you don't have to be a Masters resident to play in it. You can be anywhere in the country, anywhere in the world can play in the Mass Open. So what else can we say about?
You have to be a Mass resident to be the champion, right?
Yes, so. It's only reserved. You have to be either a resident or a student in the state of Massachusetts to win the title. Now, what's interesting about this Mass Open is that both Solon and Mika Brattain. They defeated two of the heavy favorites in this year's championship. They both beat international master Alexander Ivanov and international David Figueiredo. Mm. They're both former Mass Open champions.
Ivanov, in fact, many times, right?
14 times.
Yeah.
Ivanov has done 14, and Figueiredo has won it twice. Mm-hmm. So these were the heavy favorites. Ivanov, who's our top most active grandmaster in Massachusetts is Alexander Ivanov. He lives in Newton, and David Figueiredo, who grew up in Lexington, is now living in Andover.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but these were the players who were considered the favorites, but they were knocked out very easily.
Yeah.
So, anyways, Chess Chat fans, we hope you enjoyed the game that Dave and I presented to you. This game that Mariano Rivera, who is on a hot streak.
Yeah.
Not only at the Wachusett Chess Club, but also on tournaments on weekends, not only in Massachusetts, but I think he's going to be playing around New England. So look out for that name. He's going to be a threat to come in the future.
Yeah.
Okay, so we'll see you next time for Chess Chat. We're going to do a special tribute to one of our longtime Wachusett Chess Club members, Wayne Stebbin. That comes next time on Chess Chat.